Hi everybody and welcome. My name is Luke and this is The Science Lens, where I show you how science can improve your critical thinking skills. Today's episode is part one of two on science and advertising, and this one's all about how science can be misrepresented in marketing. As consumers, most of us want to do the right thing, whether that's for our bodies, our ethics, or for the environment. And advertisers know this, which is why so many ad campaigns are based on promoting the health or environmental benefits of a particular product. But while a lot of this information is usually based on some truth, advertisers aren't always giving you the full picture when it comes to the science behind their products. So today we're going to talk about seven ways that science is misrepresented in advertising to help you think critically about the products you spend your hard-earned money on. Now, to keep things short, I'm only going to give one example of each, but there are thousands of examples of advertisers using these techniques. So if you'd like to see some more, make sure you check out my store on Teachers Pay Teachers to see the supporting materials for today's video. It's linked down in the description below. Okay, let's get started. Number one, focusing on the good and leaving out the bad. In 2015, Nesquik found themselves in hot water over an ad campaign for their chocolate drink that used the slogan, "For a great way to start the day." The ad featured a graphic highlighting the fact that Nesquik was a source of vitamin D, zinc, and iron, but made no mention of the 20.2 grams of sugar that was also contained in every serving. A group called the Children's Food Campaign brought a complaint about the ad to the Advertising Standards Authority in the UK, arguing that it promoted unhealthy eating habits in children. The ASA agreed and ordered Nesquik to remove the slogan. Now, this is an example of a company that took things a little too far and they were hit with a fine. But the strategy of focusing on the good and leaving out the bad is still commonly used in advertising. So if you want to know the good, the bad, and the ugly of the products you buy, you need to do some reading beyond the company's messaging. Number two, using buzzwords and jargon. In 2007, a group called Sense About Science reached out to a company called ComputerClear for information on one of their products. You see, the company claimed to have developed a computer program that, quote, released bioresonance patterns through their computer screen to, quote, help rebalance the body's biofield. Come on, ComputerClear. Now, I could tell you why this is wrong, but I think it would be better if Rick Sanchez did it.
What's wrong, Rick? Is it the quantum carburetor or something?
Quantum carburetor? Morty, you can't just add a sci-fi word to a car word and hope it means something.
Now, the use of sciencey-sounding buzzwords runs a spectrum, from real words that are just overused like antioxidants to marketing words that sound legitimate like superfood. So it's important to remember that just because a word sounds scientitious, that doesn't mean that its M factor is cromulent. So if you hear a word that's new to you, make sure you read a little about it, because there's a big difference between sounding scientific and being scientifically sound. Number three, making you think you need something you don't. Alkaline water is a trend that started in 2002 when alternative medicine practitioner Robert O. Young began promoting it as a, quote, pH miracle. The claims were that using alkaline water to rebalance your body's pH would lead to everything from improved digestion to prevention of cancer. Tom Brady swears by it, Beyonce thinks it's great, so should we all be drinking alkaline water? Well, I'm sorry, Beyonce, but you should have stuck with lemonade, because the answer from the science community is a resounding no. In fact, Joe Schwartz from McGill University in Canada went so far as to say that the words absurd, ridiculous, ludicrous, preposterous, comical, and farcical aren't enough to capture his feelings on the topic. You see, your kidneys are really effective at maintaining your body's internal pH, and anything that you put into your body to try and change it will just go straight into your urine. So not only do you not need to manage your acid in your body, it's not even really physically possible. This is another example of when it's important to read reliable scientific literature about a claim before making a purchase, so that you don't fall for their alkalis. Number four, leaps of logic. In 2009, the book Born to Run was released, and many people say that it kicked off, foot pun, the barefoot running craze. The argument for barefoot running was that wearing shoes is unnatural and weakens the muscles and bones in your foot, leading to injuries. Now, the suggestion was that people would be better off if we went back to the way we ran before shoes were invented. This is the kind of logic that sounds reasonable, but it's really just an untested hypothesis. So before we all throw our runners out the window, we need to see some data. Now, as it turns out, the research in this area is a bit of a mixed bag. Some investigations say that it's great, while others say that it causes more injuries than it prevents. So I guess you could say the body of research is a little bit shoddy, shoe pun. But the takeaway here is not to let an idea that seems logical replace science and data. Number five, unregulated language. As a scientist, I'm allergic to the word proof, so I often recoil when I'm walking down the cosmetics aisle and I see the words clinically proven plastered all over the front of packaging. Now, granted, there is a second definition of the word proven that just means tested, but that's not the impression that most consumers get from the word. Cosmetics companies can use this language because they're not subjected to the same kinds of regulations that drug companies are. So nobody's banging on their door demanding to see the results of their double-blind placebo-controlled clinical trial into the effects of mascara. Now, that doesn't mean that they didn't do the tests or that their product is bad, just that the use of the phrase clinically proven isn't always tightly regulated or clearly defined. Some other words that fall into the same category are green, sustainable, organic, and natural. These are all words that appeal to us as consumers, but don't often have a clear definition that's regulated by a governing body. That's why it's important for us to do a little research into a company or product before buying to make sure that the words that they're using are backed up by their actions. Number 6, overstating the benefits. Back in 2016, the FTC in the US ordered the company Lumos to pay $2 million for claiming that their Lumosity brain training app could help prevent dementia, memory loss, and Alzheimer's disease. Brain training apps like Lumosity use puzzles and games to try and improve people's brain power, and while there is some evidence that it can help with some aspects of cognition, claiming that an app can prevent dementia is a huge overstatement. Of course, there are less blatant examples of exaggeration in advertising. Basically, anytime you see phrases like could help improve X or may lead to better Y, it should raise some questions. Now, the best way to get to the bottom of these kinds of claims is to go back to the studies that they're based on, and I have a whole other video on how to do that, so just click the link above to check that one out. Number 7, straight up lies. This one is much less common than the others because companies don't want to be sued for false advertising, but it does still happen. You may remember the story from 2015 when Volkswagen were caught in a lie about the emissions from a number of their diesel engine cars. Each of these cars was fitted with something called a defeat device that changed the performance of the car when it knew that it was being tested for emissions, making the car seem more environmentally friendly than they actually were. Now, thankfully, we have governing bodies whose job it is to prosecute companies that lie about their products. But as consumers, it's important for us to stay vigilant. Now, as I said at the start of the video, this is just a handful of examples of how science can be misrepresented in advertising. But by understanding these techniques and the ways that advertisers use them, we're better equipping ourselves to separate fact from flash and ensure that we're getting what we pay for. Well, that's it from me for today, but I'd like to mention again that I have some resources that reinforce the ideas that I covered in today's video, and you can find those on my Teachers Pay Teachers store, linked in the description down below. Don't forget to click the like and subscribe button if you enjoyed today's video and would like to see some more videos on how science can improve your critical thinking skills. And finally, I used a bunch of resources for this video that I highly recommend you check out. If you're interested in any of the topics that I covered today, they're also linked down in the description. For now though, that's it from me. Thanks for watching.